Good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting of 2016 of the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee. The committee has received apologies from the following members: Alexander Burnett, Claudia Beamish and Finlay Carson. Before we move to the first item on the agenda, can I remind everyone present to ensure their mobile phones are on silent for the duration of the meeting. The first item on the agenda is for the committee to consider whether to take items 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you, we are all agreed. The second item on the agenda is to take evidence ahead of the committee's scrutiny of the draft budget 2017-18. Last week we heard from SNH and Marine Scotland. Today we have been joined by representatives of the Scottish Environment Protection Agency. Can I welcome Joe Green, the Chief Officer for Performance and Innovation, Lynn Bunton, the Head of Regulatory Services, and David Fakeney, Flood Act Business Change Manager. So we move to questions. Kate Forbes.
Good morning and thanks for coming. My first question is on your budget for 16-17. You mentioned that a declining budget has driven innovation, but that you've been driving innovation over the last 5 years. What have been the budgetary constraints over the last 5 years? And then secondly, there was a rise in 15-16, which then decreased in 16-17. Could you explain what happened there?
I think we gave in written evidence to the committee that our budget in 2016-17 was 35.4. Just to correct that, it was actually 35.5 million. And we have seen a reduction in some granting aid over the years. Could you just ask again, it was the second question was the difference in the budgets between 2 years?
So the idea that you've been driving innovation for the last 5 years, but actually it appears that the most immediate drops in budget have been this year. So what has it been a declining budget over the last 5 years that's driven innovation, or have there been other factors too?
Yeah, I think overall we've seen a decrease in granting aid by 11% since 11-12, and we have driven innovation during this time, and also been some changes to the capital funding as well during that period as well. And the types of innovation that we've driven, we gave an example in the written evidence around reform of our science services as well. David could probably say a few words about that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Over a period of years, we've been driving down the costs of our science services. In terms of our laboratory services, we used to have 8 laboratories in Scotland. SEPA inherited 8 laboratories back in 1996. We've been driving that down through the years through developing better laboratory services and sharing those services across the organisation. And we're now down at 2 laboratories, one in Aberdeen and one in our building in North Lanarkshire. Those two laboratories take on work from all Scotland now, so they take in samples from that we take across Scotland. So we've driven efficiencies there with our lab services and with the staffing of those.
What are your expectations over the next few years?
Well, we can't predict what the level of government funding is going to be, but we do recognise that there's constraints around public sector funding in this. I guess what we're trying to do is just think very clearly about our priorities, our direction, and continue to drive innovation. It's really our statutory purpose that helps drive our priorities. And this committee a few years back took evidence on that under the Regulatory Reform Act. Our statutory purpose is to protect and improve the environment in ways as far as possible that can also deliver health and wellbeing benefits and improve sustainable economic growth. And we do focus very heavily on our statutory duties underneath that as well.
Now, how do you prioritise between those statutory duties? So what percentage of your budget is spent on regulation, what percentage is on flooding, and how are funding decisions made in relation to these?
Well, we talk about statutory purpose, and we deliver that primarily through our two core services, which are flooding and environmental regulation. It's not really a case about picking and choosing between different statutory responsibilities, and it's not really about stopping services either. We're not going to stop doing flooding or environmental regulation. It's just genuinely about finding different and better ways to do it. And most of the changes that we've driven over the last few years or improvements we would have made irrespective of the constraints around public sector budgets. And a lot of the work that we've been doing on that has been really strongly supported by the work under the Regulatory Reform Act that was passed in 2014. And that's really going to help us to drive simplification in our approach to regulation and permissions. Also gave us some new enforcement tools as well to improve our effectiveness. And so a lot of this direction is supported by that Act.
Angus MacDonald.
Yes, thanks, Convener. Good morning. You mentioned the Regulatory Reform Act, which brought you extra enforcement powers, and with it extra income, if you're going to use the new powers. How much do you expect to take in from the higher fines for non-compliance through the new powers? Do you have a figure, roughly?
So, the enforcement powers in the Regulatory Reform Act, we've got a range of new powers, including fixed monetary penalties and variable monetary penalties. But we don't receive the income from that. It goes back to the government, so it doesn't come back to SEPA.
OK, right, I wasn't aware of that. I had thought the money was to be ring-fenced for SEPA.
No, it's not ring-fenced. It just goes back, I think, into the general pot in Scottish Government. So. Otherwise, it might be an incentive for us to take lots of enforcement action.
Thank you. You've talked about your statutory duties, but you are now branching out into consultancy, as I understand it. First question would be, how much do you anticipate those activities generating? But perhaps more importantly, I presume you're aware of the potential for conflict of interest within that, as regulators and then providing that service?
Very much so. And yes, you're correct. This year, and it's only just this year that we've started to look at this, we set up a small commercial services portfolio. It currently has 3 members of staff. It literally has only just been established. And there have been a lot of discussions with the board to set a strategy around our approach to commercial services. So we're really, really conscious of the potential for conflict of interest in our consultancy approach. And so what we're looking at primarily is doing that work internationally. So there's no conflict, particularly within Scotland, about the way that we approach that.
So it will all be outward facing. None of it will be deployed within...
Well, some of the areas that we're looking at, so the consultancy primarily internationally, but there are other areas like we hold a lot of data and information. A lot of it, of course, we make publicly available, continue to do so, and increasingly. But sometimes there are people out there who want bespoke information products tailored to exactly what they need. So we're interested in exploring that. And we're also interested in exploring other sources of grant funding as well. So there's a small number of areas that we're focusing on. We've got assets, like a boat. So again, could we look at that commercially as well? So there's just a small number of areas that we're looking at commercially.
So to be absolutely clear, will there be any of it taking place in Scotland, the consultancy work, or will all of it be out with our borders?
I guess I would never want to say never, but primarily it will be internationally. And if we are doing anything in Scotland, in the case of being very, very careful, that it doesn't in any way conflict with what we do in environmental regulation.
Yeah. But if you've deployed 3 members of staff to this, you know, you obviously have to generate income. So do you have something in mind to cover those costs?
I think what we're looking at in the first year is for the cost of setting it up to be recovered. And then we'll look after that and set targets for those. But this is, it's new for us. Mm-hmm. And so we know other public sector organisations have done this, but it is new. And so we're just going to look at it, do it, and see how it progresses.
OK. Morris. Sorry, David.
If I could add a little bit to that. Our flood forecasting and warning services that we provide for Scotland, we've had approaches from overseas about how we do that. So there's opportunities to sell our knowledge and our expertise, if possible, to get other countries up and running with that, and perhaps even including that within our own services. So expanding our services in Scotland to cover other countries, for example.
Okay, that's useful. Morris Golden.
Joe, just with respect to the consultancy, you mentioned cost recovery. Do you mean the total, like full cost recovery, including, you know, anything which the three members of staff use? Are you talking about covering the staff? And secondly, in terms of the management and how those staff are operating, are you working along you know, kind of private sector models around utilisation rates, or how are they managing to configure with the rest? I mean, it's a tiny number of staff as a percentage of your total number, but I was just keen to see how you were thinking about structuring that so you could expand.
I think, again, it's only just being set up, and so we're still discussing the strategy with the board, but what we're looking at is the charging rates, but we also need to have discussions with Scottish Government around that, around income that we're allowed to keep. So we just need to, we're still working that through with Scottish Government as well.
Okay. I think it might be useful to invite you at this point to keep us appraised of the progress on that, because obviously the committee takes a good deal of interest in your work. I think it'd be useful to get updates from you if you could do that in due course.
Be happy to do so.
Yeah, okay, thank you. David Stewart.
Good morning. Continue with the theme on funding and look perhaps at other sources of funding out with your core funding. To what extent do you rely on partnership or other sources of funding like CAP Pillar 2 or structural funds or Life Plus, which obviously has big pockets in terms of environmental funding?
Certainly, I'll speak to that. So we have about £5.7 million of other income. This is primarily EU funding, and we also administer the Water Environment Fund for Scottish Government as well, which is around £1.8 million. On the EU projects, there are two main projects that we receive funding for, and that's been Scottish Environment Web and also Life Smart Waste projects. So we receive that European funding as well.
Could you identify how much European funding do you currently have in round numbers? You won't necessarily have the figure in your head, but...
Roughly, do you mind if I quote in euros?
Yeah.
So the EU investment in Scotland's Environment Web was about 2.4 million euros, and in Life Smart Waste it was about 2.1 million euros. So it gives you an idea of the scale of it.
Mm-hmm. Perhaps the depressing fact about the exchange rate is the pound's just about the euro, so I can just about work that out. Clearly, we're all struggling with Brexit and the implications of what life will be like long term. There's not a lot of certainty, but governments north and south of the border have said that they would repatriate structural funds, and there will be some understandable structural funds till 2019 anyway. Post that, who knows? What future-proofing has your organisation done to try and make up the funding that you may no longer have in a few years' time?
Well, we haven't stopped entirely engaging with the European funding process because we have some that we're already involved in. So we're not entirely pulling back from them, just proceeding cautiously at this point. And one of the main drivers for setting up that small commercial services portfolio was to look at alternative funding sources, including other sources of grant funding. And again, it's early days on that, but it's a key focus for us.
Because one of the issues you'd have picked up, and I'll bring David in a minute, one that you may have picked up from previous evidence sessions and points that we've raised is what kind of concerns me at present, certainly within Wearing My Highlands and Islands hat, is actually ability to claim and utilise structural funds has been a bit depressingly low, frankly. And I think the message I would certainly put out is we haven't left yet. There is budgets there. I mentioned the Life Plus budget is 3.4 billion euros. I mean, there's a lot of funding around. And the idea that we would suddenly stop is a mistake. But also, I think it's important that you do have some future-proofing and look ahead, because that's a sizeable amount of your overall budget, is it not?
It is, yes. That's what we're doing.
There's a number of things we're looking at within SEPA to do with Brexit. We're looking at the legislative impacts, the funding impacts, the solidarity and cooperation with other partner bodies across Europe, but also the EU nationals that are working within SEPA. But there are a number of flood risk management initiatives that touch on European funding and funding from other stakeholders. Often it's very difficult for a flood risk management project to go forward on its own because the funding doesn't quite stack up in terms of cost-benefit. So we need to look at opportunities where we can join those things together. And the Metropolitan Glasgow Strategic Drainage Partnership that started in 2002 is a really good example of how Glasgow and SEPA to start with, and now many other organisations have come together to manage flood risk in Glasgow, but also to maximise the opportunities that are around there. And it draws on, it's got this sort of 30 to 50 year vision for Glasgow. It's looking at Glasgow's future. It's looking at other opportunities to pull in money to make the things within the objectives within the strategic management partnership to be taken forward, because the individual organisations can't afford that on their own. So it's by coming together and by working as a group, but also as accessing other funds. Some of those funds are through Europe, and there are some impacts in terms of natural flood management as well, perhaps, with some of the studies that are being supported by European funding, like the Eddleston Water Study on the Tweed, and some of the SRDP funding that encourages farmers to do other things around planting and setback from rivers and so on that can benefit flood risk in upland areas. But there's a danger that the disappearing of those funds or having to seek those funds from a different source will be difficult and might impact on these if we don't find an alternative.
Mm. And again, you'll be familiar with the points that we've raised in the committee before, is there's a lot of worries post-Brexit about the World Trade Organization rules, which basically say in order to continue to trade as part of the World Trade Organization that you can't subsidise agriculture, which obviously is a shock to many of us. We don't know what the state of the nature will be, but certainly I know that Farmers Union north and south of the border are very, very worried about the future of financing of farming.
Certainly from a flood risk management point of view, I think the key thing is that we are now taking a sort of risk-based approach to flood risk management in Scotland through the Flood Risk Management Scotland Act, and we're taking a catchment approach and we're looking at sustainable solutions for 30 to 50 years ahead. And in bringing all that together, we've worked with partner organisations, the other responsible authorities, local authorities, Scottish Water, lots of stakeholders, to determine what Scotland's flood risk management objectives are and what our priorities are. So they're on the table and they're there to be done, regardless really of how they're funded or when they're funded. We have an ambition to do a certain amount of delivery of actions within the first cycle, but if we've got these things on the table for the first time now for Scotland, we know what our priorities are and we can work to achieve those regardless of whether we're going in the single flood risk management planning route or whether we're looking through structural funds or through redevelopment of city areas to ensure that those objectives are incorporated within the overall plan for that area.
I'll be raising questions, and other committee members were raising questions later on flooding, so I won't particularly raise it now, but some critics have said that if you are building in a floodplain, perhaps there should be more costs involved, not least to make sure that houses are a much higher standard in terms of avoiding flooding, but I will keep my tinder eye for future questions.
Thank you. Just to follow up on a couple of points you made there, can you put a figure on the number of EU nationals you have working within SEPA?
As far as our records show, we've got about, our staff numbers are 1,240 roughly, and according to records we've got around 40 EU nationals. And not everyone's required to provide information to us about their nationality, so that's just what we've got on record at the moment.
Okay, and can I also get an answer to a general question? The environmental regulations that we work to, that you enforce in Scotland, how would they compare to the rest of the UK? Are they of a higher standard, a lower standard, roughly equivalent?
I think very similar, but there are differences. And I guess one of the differences will be that implementation under the Regulatory Reform Act. And so we regulate under a whole different range of permitting regimes, cutting across water, waste, air, radioactive substances. And we're bringing that together into a much more simpler, joined-up approach. Now, the UK government's done something similar, but we're taking that a bit further in terms of what the ambition is there.
OK, thank you then. That's useful. Moving on to look at regulation, Angus MacDonald.
Okay, thanks, Convener. We saw news reports at the weekend highlighting an increase in non-compliance figures and breaches in pollution limits, which has certainly raised some concerns in my constituency, which includes Grangemouth. How do you propose to increase flexibility to deploy resources and to operate at a lower cost whilst delivering excellent environmental regulation, as you have stated in your report?
Adding to that, it'd be useful to get an explanation of why there has been an increase in referrals to the PF, statutory notices and final warning letters. Is that because there's a growing problem or because you're just getting better at catching people?
Okay. So we'll take those two things partly together as well. And so on compliance, what I would stress is that the overall figures showed improvements in compliance rates within Scotland, but clearly issues remaining within that. So, Lynn.
Yeah, so we've just published our results, as you mentioned. We see a total compliance figure rising to 90%, which is an improvement on last year, and it exceeds the target that we set. We apply a risk-based approach to identifying the inspection frequency, which is how we identify compliance, and that embodies the principles of better environmental regulation. We focus more on higher risk and non-compliant sites. We acknowledge that there are still difficult problems to resolve out there, but we have new tools, and I think you mentioned yourself earlier on that we have new enforcement tools, and we're also using proposing to use our compliance assessment scheme to modify our charges going forwards. This is all designed to deliver behaviour change in the operators that we are dealing with. We're also identifying sector plans as a mechanism to drive behaviour change through business to improve compliance as well. And all of this is aimed at targeting our resource most efficiently and effectively at improving the compliance of the businesses that we regulate, for the obvious reasons, I guess. The key here is about proportionate enforcement of conditions using the tools that we have. Now, we did see an increase between 2015 and 2013 of those that were ranked as excellent, so that was raising from 72% to 78%, so that's a good improvement. But we have seen an increase in those who've been non-compliant over 2 years. That's an area that we've been focusing on, and it's an area that we will continue to focus on using the new tools that we have available to us. There is always an element of movement between the figures, and just, I think the final message perhaps is that a ranking of non-compliant does not mean that there is immediate imminent harm to the environment. It may be something that is more of a management related, a management control, which could ultimately result in an impact, but hasn't at the point that the compliance assessment score has been identified and we work with those who hold licenses to improve their performance by helping them identify solutions. Where we have to enforce, we clearly enforce using the tools that we have available. Now, your second question there was around about our... Now, we will shortly be releasing our enforcement report for the year 2015. I'm trying to recall your question, convener, but I think we have an enforcement policy which we apply to all relevant infractions that we identify. I think we always improve our performance in identifying breaches, but it's a tool that they're the tools that we use when we have to use them. The benefit of what we have through the Regulatory Reform Act is that we now have better, more effective tools to bridge the gap between some of those sanctions that you mentioned. So moving forwards, we will have variable monetary penalties available to us. We have fixed penalties that we have run a campaign already using, and we have the ability to accept enforcement undertakings, which allows those who are non-compliant to take back an element of control.
It's just that there has been a marked increase under all three headings. I'm just trying to get to the root, to be absolutely clear as to what's behind that for the record.
So we have been targeting our efforts towards those who are non-compliant, which is why it is so disappointing to see the two-year non-compliant figure rising this year.
Yeah. Just to add to that, we'll be able to give more up-to-date enforcement figures to the committee, because as I say, we've just got a report going through at the moment in terms of our level of enforcement action. But just to add to what Lynn said, we published a really clear regulatory strategy back in August, and it was very clear in that strategy that we expect compliance as a minimum in Scotland from everyone. Now, publishing these enforcement figures places a spotlight on that, and that's absolutely appropriate. We talked in our written submission about regulatory strategy One Planet Prosperity, and given the challenges facing the environment facing Scotland and to allow sustainable growth, compliance is the minimum. We need to actually be encouraging businesses to go further as well. And one of the key things that we are implementing, building our skills in, is being clear about having a lot more senior level engagement and interaction with companies. To really try and push and change behaviour.
During the passage of the Regulatory Reform Bill, I remember exploring the issue where you may have a firm that has a multitude of sites, minor misdemeanours in all of them, so they get a slap wrist on each of them, and that's as far as it goes. And there was no kind of cumulative view taken about the kind of maybe the culture within the organisation. Is that something you're starting to get on top of?
Yes, it's exactly what it's talking about. We want to achieve behaviour change. That's really what regulation is all about. The new regulatory tools, enforcement tools under the Act, there was a real issue for us in that you could refer cases to the Procurator Fiscal, but there had to be a level of seriousness to be taken by the courts. It left us with a real gap. And so things like fixed monetary penalties, variable monetary penalties, and enforcement undertakings that are voluntary undertakings carried out, it all helps to take action earlier, so you can intervene to help change behaviour before it starts to become entrenched as well. So the new tools will help with that.
Angus McDonald wants to come back in.
Okay, thanks. We certainly look forward to seeing the enforcement report when it's released, and if you could share that with the committee when it's released, that would be helpful. Sticking with regulation and deploying resources efficiently and effectively, you mentioned in your report that you've significantly reduced the number and size of buildings from which you operate. I'd be keen to know how flexible SEPA is on that, because I ask because there are calls in my constituency for a dedicated SEPA office and officer in Grangemouth following the pollution breaches last year and continual non-compliance. Although I take on board the point that there is more compliance than non-compliance. But would you be willing to continually review your position regarding the siting of your offices, and will you look at further opportunities to share buildings with other public bodies, as you have done in Grangemouth in the past?
Yes, and you'll have seen we've increased the number of offices where we have shared office accommodation across Scotland without impacting on our footprint, which is really important for us in terms of our work. So yes, we're open to looking at opportunities.
I want to take this off in the direction of particular sectors. Mark Ruscombe.
Yes, thanks, Convener. Notwithstanding the overall picture, which looks positive in terms of businesses complying, sticking with the law as we would hope they would, there are a number of sectors that are problematic. Angus McDonald has mentioned Grangemouth already, but the aquaculture sector is a particular one where we're seeing a decline in compliance. It's not going up, it's going in reverse. So we've gone, I think, within the last year from 86% compliance down to 82%. Now, do you not find it problematic that SEPA is becoming increasingly reliant on industry data in order to enforce and regulate this sector? You're effectively asking the aquaculture sector to police itself.
I think with aquaculture, a couple of general points before going on to that specific one. With the aquaculture sector, we've had some real success in working with the whisky sector on a sectoral basis. And this is a sector that basically came together and said, well, there are some non-competitive issues which we can all collaborate on, which are around the environment, that are going to help us to grow sustainably in Scotland. And we've worked really actively with them. It's exactly the same way we want to work with the aquaculture sector in Scotland. And we recognise the government, the sector, want to grow. And our job is to work with them on a sectoral basis to help them grow in the right way. So that's what we want to do. On data and monitoring, we never entirely rely on data provided by others to take a view on compliance or otherwise with the sector.
But my understanding is that the tools that you've got, the modelling tools that you apply in particular to the aquaculture sector when, for example, you're making a decision about whether to issue a licence or not, are pretty much populated by data that's come from the industry. Now, if you're saying to us that you've cut your laboratories from 8 to 2, who's gathering the data? Who's gathering the data about problems such as algal blooms in our seas? Who's gathering the data about individual fish farms that are problematic, for example, off the west coast of Arran? Where is this data coming from, and how do you ensure that data is actually robust if the independent regulator isn't or doesn't have the resources to actually check up on that?
A very important point on data. I mean, all our decisions are driven by data, and we need the best data that's available to drive those decisions, regardless of what we're looking at. Over the past few years, we've been doing joint services with SNH, Marine Scotland and others. And in the aquaculture side of things, we've been doing things with Marine Scotland to share surveys, to share vessels, to share data and modelling as well. So we're using the best available data. It might not always be data that we ourselves have gathered, but it's data that's that following this risk-based approach to regulation that's required. So if we are having data provided to us, we will have sense checks on that data. And if it's telling us something that there's a problem with the data, we'll be examining that and looking to provide better data, because our decisions are driven by that. So if you have poor data, poor quality input, then you're not going to be able to make good quality decisions. So data is absolutely important for us, and we need to make sure that we're always driving the best quality data, providing that into our systems, regardless of where it comes from.
So can I just come in there? The figures that are quoted there to back Mark Ruscoe up, if the compliance level has gone down in that sector, would that trigger you to take a more proactive approach to looking at aquaculture?
Yes.
And is that happening now?
Yes, and it will increasingly continue because we adopt more of a sectoral approach.
And can I outline for us what form that would take?
Well, this is working with the industry as a whole to look at how does it want to grow, what are the constraints and opportunities around that. And so, for instance, if the industry wants to grow, then we can help Scotland think about, well, where are the areas that it could grow in environmental terms, location-wise, where there would be fewer issues. So it's working with the sector at that level as well in terms of growth.
A drop in compliance suggests that there may be a decline in culture towards compliance in the sector. Would you accept that? In which case, how do you react to that?
Well, our chief executive has been having some fairly senior level engagement with the industry. That will continue. And again, it's about that partnership that we can set up with the industry. So we've got shared aims around what we're trying to achieve around sustainable growth.
Just to follow on from that, I mean, to what extent do you feel able to actually steer the research agenda here? Because you're saying data, robust data, is important, whether we're dealing with an individual site, an individual operation, or perhaps more wider pressures on the marine environment, which aquaculture may indeed be contributing to. So when it comes to research budgets for aquaculture, 50%, I understand, is provided by Scottish Government. We have a clear, you know, objective to double the size of the industry. 50% is provided from the aquaculture industry itself. So where does SEPA fit in? You're the independent regulator. You're the one speaking up for the environment. So what about your ability to influence that research agenda? So we're actually looking at the right things.
No. We'll come back to you on that specific point in terms of how we influence the research agenda in aquaculture.
Do you have your own budget for research on aquaculture and the potential impacts of aquaculture?
Not directly, but we do try to target our research where it can bring the biggest benefits for SEPA. And we do fund a number of PhDs with SNH to look at various issues around the country. I don't know what the current list of research topics are with those PhD students, but we do have other avenues for influencing research into the different funding streams. So if there's an issue for SEPA around about that, we will be taking that forward. For example, a modelling around about aquaculture installations. We've improved greatly in that over the past few years because we've got better data on the seabed, we've got better bathymetry data, we've got better tidal data, and our modelling unit can start to pull those things together. So there's ongoing research within SEPA, within our own teams, to drive the development of the models to support our decision-making. But I'm sure we are engaged more widely, but we can get back to you on that.
You don't have your own research budget, independent research budget. You're reliant increasingly on data coming from an industry which is not complying.
No, we can tap into other research budgets that are available around Scotland and in the UK, and European research budgets as well, if appropriate. And if we're successful with the bids for that particular type of research, then we can fund that research. But we have to bid for research funding through existing pots.
It would be very useful if you could write to us in as much detail as possible. Dave Stewart, want to come in?
Just to keep
the Brexit theme, whilst it's encouraging you to do sort of funding of PhDs, Sam's from Oban, part of UHI, have submitted a paper which I've had access to, which is very worried about the future of academic funding, particularly with the uncertainty in Brexit, such as the Horizon 2020 funding. And a lot of academic funding, as you know, comes via Europe. So it's another uncertainty which presumably will affect you as well in terms of future funding of PhDs.
It may have a broader effect, but not directly with the funding of these PhDs, as far as I understand it, because they've been funded through SEPA and SNH funding, so to target work that's of particular interest to us. But as I say, we also have the majority of our funding for research is coming from local Scottish and UK funds.
So none of the European funding that you get funds PhDs?
I don't think it does at the moment.
Could you maybe... Yeah, drop us a note, just so we're totally clear. Thank you.
Okay, let's have a look at agriculture, Emma Harper.
Thank you, convener. Talking about research for aquaculture, is it similar with the agriculture then? Are you applying for research funding from external sources, or is there any agricultural research like within SEPA?
We have a soils and land team within SEPA who are driving forward their own understanding of the impacts of activity on the soils and on the land environment, and they're linked in similarly to other research pots beyond SEPA that they can tap into for that. So any theme that has an agenda that's relevant to SEPA, we can take forward through seeking funding from various research pots, and I think that the paper that we'll send back to the convener will clarify how we tap into those different funding streams from different parts of SEPA's business.
We are working with other committees, like the Rural Committee, to look at budget as well, and I'm wondering about working with the agricultural industry. Do you propose increase or decrease in the budget, because it's really difficult to get baseline information on agricultural emissions. I'm wondering, how do you think that will impact your future spend?
Well, I think there's two things. A lot of our regulatory work is funded by a charging scheme, and we implemented a new charging scheme earlier on this year, which brought together five different charging schemes into one, which was more reflective of costs of regulating different sectors. So that's the general point. On agriculture, we've worked closely with them over a number of years, particularly in tackling diffuse pollution, and we've worked very collaboratively around that with some success. And so we just seek to continue to work on a sectoral basis increasingly with the agricultural sector in Scotland.
There's probably not a harder sector to please than the agricultural sector, and yet over the last year or 2 years we started to hear more positive vibes from them about their engagement with SEPA. Is that because you've finally cracked it, or are you being too gentle with them?
So as a regulator, you can go one way or the other. What we often say to sectors or companies that you regulate is you can choose the type of regulator you get. And so sectors who are willing to work with us to improve compliance will get one type of regulator. And that's the relationship that we've really established with NFUS over the last few years. And they have very actively supported the campaigns around tackling diffuse pollution, which has been hugely welcomed.
So it's been a good example of partnership working that you might want to see with other sectors?
Yes.
OK, it's good to get that on record. Emma?
On that note, you know, there are other portfolios out there that might be pursuing priorities or spend that actually exacerbate environmental challenges, such as like road building or infrastructure. How does that impact SEPA's budget?
Well, I guess for us, our statutory purpose is broad, protecting and improving the environment in the way that also helps to improve health and well-being and helps support sustainable economic growth. So that can cut across a whole range of portfolios. We don't see other portfolios' economic growth as impacting on the environment. We think it's a win-win scenario is always possible. And increasingly what we do is we work in partnership with a lot of bodies that would fall under other portfolios in government as well. And we've got several examples of that. I mean, one would be on air quality and the work that we're doing with Transport Scotland, with local authorities on air quality. If you want to say a few words on that, Lynn.
So back in 2012, we identified some challenges, and we're now working very closely with Transport Scotland and a number of other partners in that area to look to improve the air quality, and particularly in this instance in urban areas around about Scotland. But there are some other good examples of partnership working as well. And if I come back to the NFUS question from earlier on, one of the areas where we've worked really closely with them recently has been around about plastics that have been appearing in materials going through AD plants, and working in that area, recognising the problem, identifying a solution, working upstream is the kind of tactic that we take to resolve a problem at an earlier point in the chain, if you like. In relation to the bigger infrastructure projects, we've obviously been involved over the years with the likes of Bewley Denny, the power line that was put in, with the building of a big hydropower scheme, the likes of Glendoe, which hadn't happened for a number of decades, the Waverley line being constructed down into the borders. So we've evolved our approach and are very clear about early intervention, partnership working up front, engaging with a single, identifying internally that single point of contact who brings together the key impacts to make sure that we obtain multiple benefits from the projects that are going forwards, that are clearly big infrastructure projects. We've also, through the Regulatory Reform Act, introduced recently the ability to identify a large project charge, which is something that is actually welcomed by some of the major developers. They'll actually, most of the activities that are undertaken are relatively small in individual terms. If you aggregate them together, it becomes a very large piece of engagement that we need to undertake. We've identified a mechanism by which we can raise income with the support of the project developers to cover the costs of the advice and the guidance that we provide. And I think that's seen as a very positive way forward, and it's something that we will continue to use with future infrastructure projects as well.
Okay. Okay, let's move on and look at the preventative spend issue. Jenny Goldruth.
Last week, in terms of preventative spend, we spoke to SNH about redirecting funding from other directories. As you've kind of actually alluded to this morning already, Joe Green, you spoke about SEPA's purpose, their statutory purpose being broad as an organisation. So with that in mind, I know that SEPA contributes to the government's national outcomes in terms of resilience and working with communities and schools. So have SEPA then worked previously with Education Scotland, specifically with regard to curriculum content? Because obviously you'll know that closing the attainment gap is really central to a lot of the government's work at the moment. And I wonder, therefore, if you've looked at that previously and if you're looking at that going forward.
Yes, we are. I think both on education and attainment, there are a few examples of this. And so we're doing some work on air quality, so learn about air tool, and that was an air quality teaching package developed with North Lanarkshire Council, Scotland Environment Web, in consultation with Education Scotland. And this, it's quite an innovative tool. It's the first in its kind in the UK, and it was specifically designed to support Scottish Curriculum for Excellence. And we loan air quality monitoring equipment to schools to support this. And it helps change how people think about air quality in terms of parking around schools. So that's just one example. We're also, I think, increasingly conscious of the attainment gap and the agenda around inclusive growth, and we see a direct link between that and our statutory purpose. Our shorthand we use around our statutory purpose is about that we need to help create environmental success that also creates social and economic success, so we're quite conscious of that. And we recently made a number of social pledges as well as an organisation. One of them introduced a programme of targeted mentoring of up to 20 disadvantaged pupils per year in socially deprived areas, developing foundation apprenticeships as well to help aspiring pupils from schools in areas of high social deprivation. So our target area for the first year of that is North Lanarkshire. So we're doing a number of initiatives in that area, even in terms of how we think about flood risk, where we prioritise and looking at communities that are working with there as well.
If I could add on that, Joe. In terms of flooding and flood risk in Scotland, we've been targeting schools for many years to increase the awareness of flood risk among school children within their areas, and particularly the areas most vulnerable to flooding. And in the past, that was driven by areas that had been flooded. So we would visit communities that maybe had been flooded. And as part of that recovery, we'd be going to the schools, educating them on how to stay safe, what the risks were, giving them plenty of children-focused material that they could take home and learn from it, and also encourage their parents to prepare a flood kit and to be ready for flooding. But in more recent years, we've been doing that in a more sort of structured manner, now that we know the areas at risk across Scotland, and we've been working with Education Scotland and others to target those areas. We're also involved with community safety partnerships and the work that happens to with the schools around the country, the Safe Highlanders initiative and the Safe Taysiders initiative. And through that, in 2016, we attended those and took part in those safe community partnerships with 10,000 primary seven children came through the doors of that in 2016. So they were all getting that flood message. We also developed resources with Education Scotland. That's physical resources and online resources. And you might have seen our Floodline Kids site online. That allows them to take resources into their classrooms and build that into their curriculum. And like Joe said, in terms of citizen science, we also have rainfall observers projects for the children as well, that they can have resources and can get involved with gathering that data that we need for the future to inform our decision making.
Can I just ask a follow-up question to that? This is quite specific. Do you evaluate the effectiveness of that intervention in schools? Do you go back and survey the pupils, for example, or speak to the teachers following it to see if it's actually had an impact? Because one of the things you spoke about was affecting behaviour change. And so if you're going to go back and consider how that impact has, you know, been driven in the schools, or has it changed people's behaviour in terms of flood risk, for example?
Something that we do generally with our floodline customers, but I'm not aware if it's something that we do specifically with the schools, but I'm sure as part of the Education Scotland initiative that there must be some feedback in that, so I can check and come back to this group.
Thanks.
In terms of behavioural change, I'm wondering about whether you're in any way able to monitor around air quality, if there's any impact on parents' behavioural change, because I'm thinking about if you put air quality monitoring equipment outside schools, it might persuade parents not to drive their children to schools and create the congestion around the schools, bad for the environment, etc. So I'm wondering, firstly, if you do any assessment around that, and also, how do schools go about accessing that equipment? Because I'm sure there'll be quite a few would be very interested.
Yeah, I think on the first point, again, we'll get back to the committee on that, on how the effectiveness of that is measured, because schools have been doing wider work on that as well, I know. And your second point, sorry, it was about the uptake.
Yeah,
so last year the tool was fully booked out for periods of the school term. So there is a lot of demand around this.
Enough to justify investment in more kit?
Potentially, yes, but I guess it comes back to your point again, is how effective is that intervention being?
So if you get the stats to back that up, it would justify. And it does a kind of pick up on Jenny Gordy's point about crossing over portfolios. There's the health portfolio, there's the environment portfolio, there's the education. And
I mean, the way that we have our statutory purpose, we have our two core services, flooding and environmental regulation. And then the way that we look at things is we like to get involved in a small number of other things where we can just put a bit of resource or our time and expertise in to help create significant change, and particularly if other partners get involved and they also put resource in as well. So we look at a number of these different interventions, one of which has been our support for the 2050 Climate Group, which is a group of young people in Scotland. And that group, again, working with Young Scot in Scotland as well, is looking at getting young people together, giving them leadership skills, but also an understanding in sustainability and climate change. So you're helping to create these leaders for the future, which is good for the long term. So we do a number of these different targeted interventions.
OK, thanks. Let's move on. And just a general question regarding staffing. You told us earlier, the number of staff that you currently employ. Could you advise how that has changed over the years and what perhaps the changing roles of the staff have been, the changing emphasis in the deployment of staff?
Yes, I mentioned we've got around 1,240 staff. And I guess for SEPA, the high point for us would have been about 2008-09, where we had maybe 70 more staff than that. So that's the levels that have come down since then. I guess the changing roles have reflected the changing nature in the services that SEPA provides. I mean, certainly around expertise on flood risk. And for us for the future, I've talked about what we want to do, and our regulatory strategy is really clear on this. Yes, it's absolutely about targeting non-compliance, but it's also about supporting successful innovation in the future. And so a number of areas where we need to build up our skills as an organisation, so that will just continue, and that changes the nature of some of the staff as well.
I mean, one of the strengths of SEPA has been its local footprint, the local faces, the people who know the area. Are you managing to preserve and protect that footprint, whatever the budget challenges you face?
The footprint is absolutely essential to us. I mean, as I said, if our services to the public are flooding and environmental regulation, those are locally delivered services. And so, yeah, our footprint's incredibly important. We talked about some of the changes we're making to estates and sharing of offices, but that's not about impacting on our footprint.
Good to hear. David Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Could I raise an issue again around flooding? And I met Joe Green last week, and I think I gave some notice about this question. I'm very concerned about where there's planned development on floodplains, where SEPA have said there should be no development. Presumably you're a statutory consultee for local authorities, but that either the planning authority or an appeal has rejected your advice. Now, I haven't got the figures in my head, but I pick up around 20 plus with the number of times that has happened. And to be honest, that is a completely mad set of priorities, not for SEPA, but for local authorities and for Scottish Government. What they then find is developments get built, developments then get flooded. Householders face chaos and personal tragedy because of that, and something that could be avoided. Do you know offhand how many times this has happened over the last 4 or 5 year period?
Yeah, well, I can certainly speak about that, Mr. Stewart. SEPA is a statutory consultee in the land use planning system, and we see in excess of 2,500 applications a year where flood risk is a consideration that we have to take on. We have the evidence around about our flood maps and the information that we gather about flooding when it happens and from our hydrometric network, our gauging stations. So we know the issues around flooding. And Scottish planning policy is very clear in its framework about what should be permitted in terms of building and what shouldn't be in terms of the floodplain and the risk that particular part of the floodplain has. So we shouldn't be building hospitals and schools and critical infrastructure anywhere at all in the floodplain. Decisions for planning authorities. Housing shouldn't be being built anywhere that's at risk of the 0.5% of flooding in any 1 year, percent chance of flooding in any 1 year, or the 1 in 200 year floodplain, and below that, nothing should be getting built at all. But there are pressures around Scotland, especially in the city areas. There's also pressure around about where brownfield sites are needing to be brought forward for development. There's also pressures where houses already exist on floodplain, and there's 108,000 properties that we've identified at flood risk in Scotland. So they are at flood risk at the moment. We're reducing that by putting measures in place. But those properties, unless we encourage retreat and actually take these properties out of the floodplain, they're going to be there and they need to be managed. So planning authorities have a number of things that they have to look at in terms of coming to a decision, and flood risk is only one of
those. Sorry, cutting across, could you just flag some of that up, because I may forget, if not. You probably called for me to give evidence from the chair of the Climate Change Committee that one of the risks for Scotland was that 90% of houses which are at flood risk don't have a flood prevention strategy from the local authority, which is really extremely worrying.
Well, I think that shows the size of the issue that we've got in Scotland. Yeah. There's 108,000 properties at risk. If the measures that go forward, the big flood prevention measures that are there, flood protection measures that are there that go forward in the first cycle, that's in the next 6 years, there'll be 42 of those coming forward. That will reduce the number of properties at risk by about 10,000. But it's a long game. We have a long way to go in terms of reducing.
So just in the future again, so we don't lose this. So you 2,500 applications a year.
Yes.
How many occasions was your advice as SEPA overturned by either the Local Authority Planning Committee or an appeal to the Scottish Government?
In 2015, we had 22 objections.
So it wasn't far wrong.
No, 22%, that's less than 1% that we objected to. Nine of those were approved against SEPA advice. So only nine out of 2,500 or thereabouts.
And of these nine developments, you probably don't have these figures to hand, but how many houses are we talking about?
We're talking about a low number of houses. These are individual households, really, or are travelling people's sites, as we have been recently. So they're caravan parks and housing individual, or maybe one, two, three properties.
So that was nine per year. Yeah. Could you perhaps drop us a line and identify how many houses are affected? Because clearly, if you're the person that's flooded, whether you're the only one in Scotland, the tragedy is there. What I'm trying to get at is, I would rather see the figure being zero. If you're the professional advisors, if you say there shall not be any building because we think there'll be a long-term problem with flooding, there shouldn't be any building. And whether it's the local councillors or whoever's in government overturning that, in my view, that's a mistake because these problems will come home to roost in the longer term.
Yes, that is the ideal. And it will become more of a challenge with climate change because there's another 70,000 or thereabouts properties that we've identified that will become at risk by 2080. Mm-hmm. Under the climate change scenarios that we're running with. So we could just be running to stand still, if you like, with it.
So presumably, as the climate change chair said, climate change is with us now. So presumably, areas that are not currently floodplains are at risk, may well be floodplains, because it's the 5% issue you mentioned.
That's a very interesting point. That's to be determined, because quite often the floodplain is defined and doesn't change, because floodplains defined naturally by our geology and so on, so it's the width of the floodplain, and you can imagine that as the river valley, if you like. So with climate change and increased flood peaks that we anticipate, you probably get a similar area flooded, maybe slightly bigger area, but it might be deeper and it might be faster flowing, so the risk might change. So
finally, I know the convener once again, so final point. Thanks for that figure. Could you give us the figures for each of the last 4 years on how many times your advice was ignored by either planning or by the government? And in each case, how many houses were affected? Because that's absolutely crucial that we know the actual numbers. Because we had some hint in these figures before, but that's really interesting advice. Yeah. I suppose the overall question is, do you have sufficient resources to deal with giving advice to planning authorities on risk of building and floodplains?
Because
there's staffing issues here.
It is tight for us. We've seen the number of these increasing because pressure increases to build in floodplains, especially within urban areas where redevelopment is required. And it's very difficult because flood building in the floodplain or not building in the floodplain is the single biggest flood risk management tool in the toolbox. If you avoid putting people at risk of flooding, then that's... So you're right, Mr. Stewart. Ideally, nothing gets built in floodplain, and that would be where we were aiming, but other things have to be taken...
That's very helpful. Thank you.
Just following up on that very important line of questioning from David Stewart, some of the committees tried to explore before us. Does anyone keep a record of the consequences of where your advice has been overruled? Do you keep a record? Other examples, perhaps going back to 2012, 2010, where you've objected that it's gone ahead and there have then been issues arisen. Do you kind of keep an eye on these things?
Yeah, that's something that doesn't come back to SEPA because that information stays with the planning authorities, and that information would be very powerful if it was fed back to us. But it's very difficult to get a handle on that because we are seeing things at the planning stage, and planning doesn't always go forward. And then things aren't built as they were proposed. There's a slight change to that. So we don't know, and we don't have the resources, and it's not our remit either, to go out on the ground and check what was actually put.
I think David Stewart wants to come back.
Convener, it just seems to me there's a good link here from your previous comments about PhD work. This seems a really good piece of academic research that you might want to get some eager PhD student to go away and research all this.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. Mark Roscoe.
Yeah, if we could just look in a little bit more detail at SEPA's changing role in relation to flooding, perhaps over the last couple of years. How has that changed? I mean, let's take an application, say, for a major housing development in an area which is, you know, identified as risky in terms of flood. Where would SEPA's role kind of stop, and where would local authority flood officers teams actually come in to take on that work? And has that changed over the last 2 to 3 years?
Well, with implementation of the Flood Risk Management Scotland Act, it's very clear that we need to take a risk-based approach to flood risk management. And in the first schedule of that Act, Section 1 says that all responsible authorities have to take flood risk into consideration in all their duties. So the planning authorities must take flood risk into consideration in all their duties. So that's been a very powerful thing for everyone in Scotland, to ensure that at the earliest possible stage we're involved with understanding the flood risk for potential developments, and starting at the early doors stage, where we can get in and do pre-application discussions and even strategic flood risk assessments. SEPA, these 2,500 individual applications that come through, SEPA is also involved with looking with local authorities to work through their development plans to see how they have zoned land and how the zoning of land can be lined up with the flood risk, to make sure that at that zoning stage the councils and the local authorities and the other planning authorities are taking full recognition of the flood risk. So it's that early stage. Also, for big infrastructure projects like the A9 and the A96 rerouting, come to SEPA nice and early. We've been engaged with them on flood risk for the whole job, rather than coming through at the planning stage for individual sections. So being able to work strategically from the outset with other organisations to plan things holistically to ensure that flood risk has been met is really powerful, and the Act allows us to do that.
So I think we had a similar answer from SNH last week. There's been a bit of a retreat, if you like, in terms of analysing individual applications, and much more work early on, taking a strategic approach, getting local development plans right, getting housing zoned in the right places. What happens then when an application goes through to public inquiry or appeal and it needs a specialist independent regulator? Who picks up that work now?
Well, it would be referred by if SEPA objected to it, it would be referred to the Scottish Government reporter, who would have a look at that. And at that stage, we might be asked to give, well, we will be asked to give information on it and evidence, and that would then be out of our hands, if you like, in terms of the decision. SEPA is a statutory consultee in the planning process, so we need to make sure that we have laid out all the information, all the advice and all the guidance, the data, to enable a good decision to be made on that. And that is our role, to make sure that we're feeding that process.
Do you not see that local authorities are maybe picking up more of this work now through their flood teams?
The local authorities, yeah, they have their flood teams, but they also have their planning teams, and it's how they work together and how closely they work together within the local authorities is very important, to make sure that both those teams within the local authority have got visibility, and that they're coming to other organisations like SEPA through the process as one.
Right, so I'm just trying to be clear here. What you're saying is that SEPA will take a planning application in terms of its advice right the way through to decision. You'll be involved in appeals, you'll be involved in public inquiries. You'll be the lead agency, is that what you're saying?
No, we're not the lead agency for providing that input and advice on flood risk management. We're not the decision makers, and we're not the planning authority. But we need to make sure that our advice is presented, and that our opinion has been listened to.
Right, okay.
Okay, thanks. Maurice Golden.
I was just following on within the flooding section, how much SEPA spends on nature-based solutions and what more you should be doing in this area?
I don't have the figure for that
okay.
directly, Mr. Golden, but we do get involved through partnership working with initiatives that are happening out there to try and understand the how natural flood management can be incorporated within our flood risk management actions. Mm-hmm. We've identified areas in the flood risk management strategies that we've put together. We've identified areas around Scotland where there is potential for that. We're working with other organisations who are taking forward initiatives like the Tweed Forum and the project that's going forward in the Eddleston Water, where there's 17 farms there, and I think now that are signed up to that, to try and understand through an improved monitoring process what impact natural flood management can have on reducing flood peaks for areas at risk downstream. We have produced a very comprehensive, earlier this year, we produced a very comprehensive natural flood management handbook, which is available and to everyone. It's online and it can be accessed by landowners or by funders or by government to decide the best techniques and processes and perhaps suggest ways of accessing funding as well to take forward natural flood management actions. So we have one member of staff who's full-time on natural flood management. We have others who spend a little bit of time on that, one within the flooding team, but we also can access expertise through other parts of SEPA, through our ecology team and through our hydrogeomorphologists.
Thanks. Can I ask then, there is a move here to develop the land use strategy and very much localise it across Scotland to deliver sort of regional or very local plans. Would you say a role for SEPA participating in the development of those plans from the sort of areas of interest that you have?
We must have an interest. So we can maybe come back to the committee on that. Clearly we do a lot of work at local level, but we can come back to the committee specifically on the land use strategy.
Okay, thank you. Kate Forbes.
Just lastly, going back to funding, what processes do you employ to ensure such a small underspend annually?
Yes. Well, for us, clearly, we don't want to work at an overspend. And so it's just a process of actively managing our budgets within that one-year cycle. Clearly, some of the projects, some of the work that we do, it spreads over several years. But we're obviously in the public sector going on that one-year cycle. So it's just a case of actively managing it. And if pieces of work are not coming forward, we might look at reprioritisation during the year. And we work quite closely with our sponsor team in government on that as well.
Morris Gordon.
Yeah, just following up on that, obviously your underspend's very impressive, so I'm keen to tease out if there's anything particularly that you're doing that some of the other agencies aren't. And I mean, it could be, for example, you do have high numbers of staff with respect to high numbers versus budget versus some of the other agencies. I'd be interested to learn from you if that reflects your functions or an approach or a difference in approach versus other agencies, e.g. do you have a tendency to deliver in-house rather than contracting out? And also it'd be interesting to know how much you have, you know, kind of fixed costs versus variable costs. So how, you know, is that the reason around the underspend, or are there some other aspects, for example, an internal audit function that you're conducting that perhaps isn't seen by others, or, you know, you may have other aspects, your approach to risk management. I'm just keen to tease some of those issues out.
I think you're right in that different agencies are different, and so it can make it trickier in terms of underspend. I think with SEPA, it's roughly about 65% of our income is staff or staff costs. You know, so that's quite high. About 22% is on supplies and services, things like replacement equipment, and our contract with the Met Office, stack monitoring. So we have some of these, but some of these contracts are quite long-standing as well. And so it will partly be, I would love to say we're doing everything right and others could learn from us, but it will be partly about the nature of our business as well.
In terms of flood risk management, it's about the same. It's about 60-40, 60 on staff and 40% on non-staff. I would say that I think SEPA's, in my view, SEPA's successful because we've spread across so many different activities, and some of those activities can be flexible and some are more fixed. If we're meeting statutory deadlines, for example, for producing flood maps or something, we're absolutely locked into that in any one year. But we have to plan for about 6 years to deliver those, so all in a six-year cycle, so it's difficult planning across the year. So we use the flexibility within the rest of the organisation to move money within the organisation to meet targets that benefits the whole organisation. And sometimes there's a little bit of flexibility that can take us beyond the end of the financial year. So by bringing some of our expenses forward and then pushing some of our expenses into the following year. So there's a bit of you know, there's a bit of flexibility there with our own deadlines, but we're absolutely fixed on our statutory deadlines.
So with this underspend, that's, you know, great to see. Were your staff working in advance on this, on the previous year's financial budget? So, you know, are you planning ahead, even though you don't know what the budget is, to enable you the flexibility to get so close to the mark on a kind of yearly basis? Is that the way you manage to work it so successfully?
Yeah, well, in terms of flood risk management, we have to think well ahead. We're thinking about 6 years ahead. And because some of the things we've been taking forward in this first cycle have been the first time that Scotland's ever done it, there have been real estimates, because we had no idea. Well, we did have an idea. We estimated what the costs might be and how many staff we would need. And there is rigorous a process as that is possible when you're doing something the first time. But you do find that you need some latitude within that to be able to deliver things and to think ahead. The Scottish Government, we've worked very closely with our colleagues in Scottish Government, so whilst we only get a one-year settlement for our flood risk management, at the moment, for our flood risk management funding, we've never failed to get that. So they tell us to plan on what we're planned on last year, and we work on that.
Briefly to that, we're just about to launch into our next corporate plan, which will set a high-level direction for several years. But we produce an annual operating plan as well, and we work again closely with government in developing those annual operating plans. And more recently, we've set up two new committees. So there's an agency management team that leads the agency. We set up a committee on flooding and a committee on regulation at agency management team level. Just again to bring additional focus to those two services and allow decisions to be taken well within the year as well.
Okay. I think we've covered all the areas we were looking to cover. Can I thank the witnesses very much for your attendance this morning? That's been a very useful session. At its next meeting on the 22nd of November, the committee will consider the draft Crown Estate Scotland Interim Management Order. As agreed earlier, we'll now move into private session, and I ask that the public gallery be cleared as the public part of the meeting is now closed. Thank you.